For it all, oh God, I say I love you. For the cross you bore, every nail and thorn. For it all, oh God, I say I love you. All I have inside, heart, soul, and mind. For it all, oh God, I say I love you.
Hi, this is Marlene Elizabeth, and this is for Sect Foolish Channel, where I screen share Bible studies word for word. This will be a continuation of the Salt of the Earth series, looking at female characters, which we'll be touching on Sarah today. So the question is, who is Yisrâʾêl? Did you know Abraham's seed comes through the woman? A strange statement which often gets scoffed at, overlooked, ignored, and played down as, yes, women give birth. But there is a deeper understanding giving us clarity on who is Yisrâʾêl. Next slide. And this is such a strange statement when I heard it 5.5 years ago. Naturally, I started looking into it because of my task of finding a true divinity of Eve, which is given to me in 2018. Look to the balance of the female equation. There is hidden the true divinity of Eve. And the female equation, there is a power and a presence that is yet to be uncovered. It's been stifled. The female equation is like looking at the characters, the female characters, and they add up to a power that needs to be revealed. Most of the interpretation has come from a masculine perspective, and this power has been stifled. So this is yet to be revealed, to really try and see and uncover what these women are representing. So that was my task. The body of Christian teaching, that's doctrine, is concerned only with the patriarchs, which form the base of Christian understanding. So to give you an idea what patriarchs are, it's a Strong's word, G3966. It's a progenitor. Webster's 1913 dictionary, progenitor, to bring forth, to beget, an ancestor in the direct line of a forefather. This is an Igor lexicon, the father of a chief of a race, a patriarch. Taylor lexicon, a patriarch, founder of a tribe, progenitor. It's used to David, of the 12 sons of Jacob, the founders of the several tribes of Yisrâʾêl, of Abraham, the same, and of Isaac and Jacob. In the Bible sense, patriarch, a father of a nation or lineage. And whilst you won't find the word matriarch in scripture, we find an entry in the Urban's Dictionary of the Bible, matriarchs, symbolically considered the mothers of Yisrâʾêl. Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, and Rachel were the wives of the patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, forebears of the 12 tribes of Yisrâʾêl. Their stories are beautifully narrated in a high literary style and form a cohesive whole in the saga of the early patriarchal age. And Webster's 1913 Dictionary for Matriarch, the mother and ruler of a family and her descendants, a ruler by maternal right. Next slide. In this video, we're going to follow the covenant given to Abraham and Sarah right through to Jesus and us today. Who is Yisrâʾêl? Okay, so in the Bible sense, patriarch is the father of a nation or lineage. And that's what Abraham's name means. So in Genesis 17:4-5, the sign of the covenant, God speaking to Abraham, thou shalt be a father of many nations. I'll just play this.
As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee.
Rightio. So God's making a covenant with Abraham, and a covenant is Strong's word 1285, it's bereath, in the sense of cutting, a compact because made of passing between two pieces of flesh. Brown Dover Briggs says a covenant is a divine constitutional ordinance with signs or pledges, and I've highlighted pledges because that relates to my task, right? With Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Bible sense for a covenant, a contractual arrangement between God and a person, or between human beings, which required binding action from one or both parties. One party often had a higher status in the arrangement. And the Greek alignment for covenant is deitheke. It is disposition that is especially a contract, especially a divisory or will. So they've got it as testament, or translated as testament, as well as covenant. Okay, next slide.
As for me, behold, my covenant is...
Okay. So I'll continue playing this. It's Genesis 17:67, sign of the covenant.
And I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee.
So the covenant here is talking about the seed. God will establish his covenant with Abraham and his seed. And the seed is Hebrews word 22:33, Zera. Seed, figuratively, fruit, plant, sowing time, or posterity. Brown Diver Briggs, seed is an offspring, posterity. This is the Jensenius lexicon. It says offspring, and the Bible sense also says offspring. Okay, and the Webster's 1913 dictionary for posterity, the race that proceeds from a progenitor. So Abraham is the progenitor, and the offspring to the furthest generation. The aggregate number of persons who are descended from an ancestor of a generation. Okay, so Christian doctrine focuses mostly on the patriarchs when looking at the everlasting covenant. Even the Jews disputed with Jesus about the seed of Abraham, and many today fail to notice, even ignore the fact the covenant was also made with Sarah.
And I will make thee exceeding fruitful.
So, Jesus is speaking with the Jews in this verse. I'll just play it.
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, If ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, We be not born of fornication, we have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, If God were your father, ye would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech, even because ye cannot hear my word? Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God.
Okay. So Jesus is speaking with the Jews in this section here, and the Jews are descendants of Judah. So I've just shown you here the Jews belonging to Judah. descendant of Judah. Okay, Judah is the fourth son born to Jacob with his wife Leah. So we have Abraham's wife Sarah, who had Isaac. Isaac, who married Rebekah and had Esau and Jacob. And Jacob had his first wife. He had a couple of wives. His first wife was Leah, and Leah had Judah. Judah was the fourth of the 12 sons of Jacob. So that's who Jesus is talking to. So the Jews are saying in verse 33, we be Abraham's seed. And Jesus acknowledges that they are the physical seed in verse 37. I know you are Abraham's seed. And then the Jews say to Jesus, Abraham is our father. And Jesus answered and said, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. And he says, you do the works of your father. Ye are the father. Ye are of your father, the devil. So, just to show you what's going on here.
And ye shall know the truth.
So not all seed is the seed of Abraham. God will establish his covenant with Abraham and his seed. This is in Genesis 17:7. The word seed here is Zera, which is posterity, right? Now the Jews say in verse 33, we be Abraham's seed. And it's a different word for seed. It's G4690. And it's sperma. And there's something sown that is seed, including the male sperm. By implication, offspring. The BDAG lexicon confirms it. The product of insemination, posterity and descendants. The Tay lexicon, the semen virile by meton. The product of the semen, seed, children, offspring, progeny, family, race and posterity. Okay, oops. Like I said, Jesus acknowledges the Jews are a physical seed. We can see this expounded upon when Jesus responds in verse 39. If you were Abraham's children, the difference is in the seed, right? Next slide. John 8:39. They answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. And Jesus saith unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. So here we have children. It's G5043, technon. It's a child as produced. BDAG lexicon says, one who has the characteristics of another being a child, of those who exhibit the virtues of ancient worthies, the children of Abraham. The Tay lexicon says, universally and without regard to sex, with emphasis, genuine posterity, true offspring. The Bloomfield lexicon, meaning true children, genuine descendants. The TDNT lexicon says, the child from the standpoint of origin. In the New Testament, the word is used both generally and also in very specific senses. It can also mean progeny, especially Abraham's children. First, his physical descendants, and then his spiritual progeny. So Jesus is clearly talking about something different to the Jews. Children exhibit the virtues of the father. True children, genuine descendants, are the spiritual progeny. And Jesus expounds on this further. Let's listen again.
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication, we have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, If God were your father, ye would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech? Even because ye cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God.
So I hope that's pretty clear for you. I'll go to the next.
And
one.
Ye shall know.
So this distinction has not been hidden. We find it in other scriptures. So the cross first for Abraham is our father. It's Matthew 3:7-9 and Luke 3:7-8. I'll just play it.
But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance, and think not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. Then said he to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits worthy of repentance, and begin not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham.
So as you can see, John the Baptist is saying a very similar thing to what Jesus is saying. God is able to raise these stones up to the children of Abraham. So it doesn't necessarily need physical.
But when he saw many of...
Next slide. The children of promise are Abraham's spiritual progeny. They're spiritual descendants. Romans 6:9. I'll just play it here.
Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son.
Okay, so children here is technon. It's the same as children on the other slide. It's first his physical descendants, then his spiritual progeny. So we're talking the children of God are the are his spiritual progeny, not the children of flesh. Not all Israel are Israel. Not because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. So I called this series of videos Salt of the Earth, which is based off my message that I received in 2018, focuses on the Holy Spirit. It's very crucial in opening up the understanding of what's been promised to us as the human race in connection with pledges and promises, relates to a covenant, the salt of the earth as a starting point, salt as sustenance, spiritual food. Now we're currently talking about the children of promise that are counted as seed in relation to the covenant God made with Abraham and his seed. So the children of promise, which you saw on the previous slide, promise is Epangelia. It's an announcement for information, assent, or pledge, especially a divine assurance of good. BDAG says, declaration to do something with the implication of obligation to carry out what is stated, promise or a pledge. In our literal, more generally of divine promises, it's God's promise. Children of promise, that is, those born because of the promise. The theological, Lexham Theological Word Book, promise, a pledge to do something that obligates the pledger to follow through. The TDNTA lexicon, the content of the promise. The content is messianic salvation as inheritance, life, spirit, righteousness, and sonship. The Tay lexicon, promise, the act of promising, a promise given or to be given, born in accordance with the promise. So the focus on the Holy Spirit is crucial in opening up new understanding of what's been promised us as a human race. In connection with pledges, promises, relates to the covenant. So I've kind of color-coded it here for you. So in the New Testament, we are told God's chosen people, that is, they which are the children of flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of promise, are counted for seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. Okay, so we've got that in the Old Testament. So it's a cross verse for Romans 9:9. Isaac's birth promised, my covenant will I establish with Isaac, which Sarah shall bear unto thee at this set time in the next year. So continue on, Genesis 18:10. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of thy life, and lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard in the tent door which was behind him. And again in Genesis 18:14, is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of thy life, and Sarah shall have a son. And again, for Sarah conceived, this is Genesis 21:2, Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time of which God had spoken to him. So this is a big deal because Abraham was 100 years old and I think Sarah was 90 years old when she had Isaac. So she was well past childbearing years, and God was still able to give Sarah a son. So the cross verse for Romans 9:9 is Hebrews 11:11. By faith, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. She judged God faithful. Hebrews 11:17-18. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it is said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Okay, that's just showing you Old and New Testament saying the same thing. Abraham had many children, but only one child was the heir that was promised, and it was with his wife Sarah. Sarah gave her handmaid Hagar to Abraham, who bore Ishmael. When Sarah died, Abraham took another wife and had more children. This is in Genesis 25:1-2. And his other wife was Keturah, and she had Zimran, Jokshan, Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shuah. So Abraham had a lot of children, but only one was his promised child. And my task is to find true divinity of Eve and to look at the female characters, and they add up to the power that needs to be revealed. Now that I have shown you the patriarchal importance, we must look at the matriarchal importance, which is often overlooked and misunderstood. So this is the excerpt from Erdman's dictionary. I've already read that out. This video will focus on Sarah, and my plan is to look at Rebecca, Leah, and Rachel in future Soul of the Earth videos. But today we're just looking at Sarah. So in Hebrews, I'll just play it.
And God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. In all that Sarah hath said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, which she had borne unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, Cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son. And God said unto Abraham, Let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. In all that Sarah hath said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called.
Okay, and I've given you the word definition of cast out here. Cast out this bondwoman and her son means to drive out from possession.
And God said unto Abraham, Let it not.
Next slide. So we are told Ishmael was mocking, but what really happened that caused Sarah to tell Abraham to cast out the bondwoman and her son, Ishmael? We have an account of it in the book of Jasher. 21:13-15. And when Isaac was 5 years old, he was sitting with Ishmael at the door of the tent. And Ishmael came to Isaac and seated himself opposite to him. And he took the bow and drew it, and put the arrow in it, and intended to slay Isaac. And Sarah saw the act which Ishmael desired to do to her son, and it grieved her exceedingly on the account of her son. And she sent for Abraham and said to him, Cast out this bondwoman and her son, for her son shall not be heir with my son. For thus he did seek to do unto him this day. So the Jasher account is backed up in Galatians. And I'll just play it here.
Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do ye not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, Rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not, for the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free.
Okay, so he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit. So the one that was born after the flesh was Ishmael. Ishmael persecuted Isaac. That word persecute means to pursue, chase, in war or hunting, which is exactly what we have in the account of the book of Jasher. Ishmael had a bow, drew it, put the arrow in it, and intended to slay Isaac. So he's intending to hunt him. So I believe that that kind of confirms that account there. Anyway, this study will circle back to Galatians 4. So sorry that it played all that. I only wanted to look at these two verses. Next slide.
Tell me.
God made a covenant with Abraham and his wife. And here's a side-by-side of what God said to Abraham and what God said to Sarah. So in Genesis 17:1-6. When Abraham was 90 years old and 9, so he was 99, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me and be thou perfect, and I will make a covenant between me and thee, and I will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations I have made thee. And that's what his name means. And I'll make thee exceedingly fruitful, and I'll make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. So this is what God is saying to Sarah in Genesis 17:15-16. And God said unto Abraham, as for Sarai thy wife, thou shalt not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall her name be. And I will bless her and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations, and kings of people shall be of her. So Abram becomes the father of many nations, and Sarah becomes the mother of nations. Kings shall come out of Abraham, and kings of people shall be of her, Sarah. So it's very similar. And I've given you the definition for here for the word bless. It's Strong's 1288. It's Barak. It means to kneel, by implication to bless God as an act of adoration, and vice versa, man as a benefit. The Bible sense is to bless, to invoke or enact divine favor, often implying a positive disposition or kind actions towards the recipient. The How Lexicon says, God to bless, it means to endue someone with special power. God's going to endue Sarah with special power. Next slide. Notice Sarah received a blessing, meaning she was endued with special power. Ever looked into Israel's name? It was the new name given to Jacob after he wrestled with God. This is Israel, Hebrew word 3478. It comes from the word 8280, which is Sarah. And I'll show you here. And the other word comes from is El. El means the Almighty God. He will rule as God. Israel, a symbolical name for Jacob, also typically of his posterity. And notice Israel from 8280 uses power in Genesis 32 and 28 and Hosea 13 and 3. So in Genesis 32:28, Jacob wrestles with God, and he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel, for as a prince hast thou power with God, and with men has prevailed. And Hosea 12:3 is Israel's history. He took his brother by the heel in the womb, and by his strength he had power with God. So this is talking about Jacob and how his name was changed to Israel because he had power with God. And this word powers, H8280, it's Sarah, means to prevail, have power as a prince. And the Greek alignment is to strengthen and confirm, to invigorate. And the Greek alignment only appears twice in the New Testament. I've given the example here, Luke 22:43, prayer on the Mount of Olives, and there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. So an angel appeared, strengthening Jesus, giving Jesus power. Acts 9:19, the conversion of Saul to Paul, and when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples, which were at Damascus. So it's just very interesting there. Okay, back to Genesis 17:19-21. And God says, Sarah thy wife shall bear thee a son indeed, and I shall call his name Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. And as for Ishmael, I have heard thee. Behold, I have blessed him, and will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. 12 princes shall he beget, and I shall make him a great nation. But my covenant will I establish with Isaac, which Sarah shall bear unto thee at this set time in the next year. So this is Isaac, Strong's word 33:27. It comes from 67:11, which is laugh. So Isaac's name means laughter, that is mockery. Isaac, son of Abraham. In Genesis 21:9-10, and Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, which she had born unto him, unto Abraham, mocking. So it's just interesting around Isaac's name. Hagar was mocking. Was mocking Isaac. And in Genesis 17:17, then Abraham fell on his face and laughed, and he said in his heart, shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old, and Sarah that is 90 years old to bear? And a lot of people seem to forget that Abraham laughed. They seem to remember that Sarah laughed, but they forget that Abraham laughed also. In Genesis 18:12, then therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also. Like I said, the focus always seems to be on the patriarchs. And even if they look at the matriarchs, being Sarah, Rebecca, etc., they misunderstand what's going on with the women, and they'll just paint the women as bad. Sarah's bad because she laughed at God's promise of a promised son, and totally ignore the fact that Abraham laughed also. And I say this to point out that I think it's a prophecy. We can't take for granted when words appear twice in a verse that they can mean the same thing. This verse is a great example. And Sarah said, God hath made me laugh so that all that will hear will laugh with me. So this, I've color-coded here, this laugh here is 67:12. Laughter in pleasure or derision. The DBL says, DBL lexicon, is Dictionary of Biblical Languages. Laughter, that is the act of making guttural sounds as a response to a situation. Note that laughter can be in joy or in mocking. And the Bible says laughter in the vocal activity of laughing, the manifestation of joy or mirth or scorn. so the blue one here will laugh. It's 67:11. That's where they get the laugh for Isaac's name. To laugh outright in merriment or scorn by implication to sport. Dictionary of Biblical Languages, laugh, that is, make a guttural sound related to irony or humor, often with the associative meaning of mocking or reviling. Okay. And God said, Sarah said, God hath made me laugh so that all that hear will laugh with me.
And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did unto Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived, and bare Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son that was born unto him, whom Sarah bare to him, Isaac. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac, being 8 days old, as God had commanded him. And Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born unto him. And Sarah said, God hath made me to laugh, so that all that hear will laugh with me. And she said, who would have said unto Abraham that Sarah should have given children suck? For I have borne him a son in his old age.
So Isaac's name is very interesting. It points to mocking or rejoicing. Even in the Bible, exhaustive Bible names, book, it has 2 entries for Isaac. One is laughing, he laughs. The other one is in mockery, he will laugh in mockery. So in Genesis 21:9, Sarah saw the son of Hagar, which is Ishmael, the Egyptian, which she had born unto Abraham, mocking. So Ishmael was mocking Isaac. And this is Genesis 21:6. This is Septuagint. This is the Greek Old Testament. And Sarah said, the Lord has made laughter for me, for whoever hears will rejoice with me. Okay, so in relation to the covenant, got the two covenants. For it is written that Abraham had 2 sons, one by a bondmaid and the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise, which things are an allegory. For these are the 2 covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to and answereth to Jerusalem, which is now, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, Rejoice, thou barren, and bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate have many more children than she which hath a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. I mean, Abraham had more children, but it's just talking about the two sons, one from the bondmaid, the other from the free woman. So that was Hagar, and this was Sarah. So in John 8:37, Jesus says to the Jew, I know you're Abraham's seed. Then the Jews say, but Abraham is our father. And Jesus answers, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. So not all seed, sperma, are the promised seed, Zera. They're two different seeds. Two definitions for seed. In Isaac shall thy seed be called and counted as promised seed, which is this one here. But also children, true descendants, that is spiritual progeny, not yet born, not of works, but according to God who calls by faith. So I'll just play this here. It's going to read out this scripture.
Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children. In Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, it was said unto her, The elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Not...
Okay. So... Just following it on, and I'm sorry if some of these verses are repetitive. It's just to help you follow this through. This is living by faith.
Through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many, as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable. And being not weak...
So just to give you an understanding of what dead means, this is the cross verse for it.
Weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure.
Okay, by Abraham's faith, the sacrifice of Isaac was transferred to Jesus. God will provide his own lamb. Isaac's seed is called through God. So, this is where Abraham was tried. It says here, by faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. So, this is just following this through in Scripture.
And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham, and said unto him, Abraham? And he said, Behold, here I am. And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass, and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship, and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering, and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father, and said, My father. And he said, Here am I, my son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. And they came to the place which God had told him of. And Abraham built an altar there, and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand, and took the knife to slay his son.
Sometimes when we're reading, we kind of don't really understand the emphasis of what's going on here. Abraham was a very old man before he got his promised son, his inheritance. And when he finally gets his son, God says, Now go and take your son up to this mountain and offer him for a burnt offering. And Abraham's faith, he just went and did it. Offered up his promised seed, his promised son, willing to sacrifice Isaac for God. It's quite amazing.
And it...
I'll read the rest of this scripture here.
And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Lay not thine hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram, and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, In the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time, and said, By myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. And the angel of...
So faith is not a New Testament teaching. It's been since the beginning of the Old Testament. In Hebrews 11, by faith we understand. I'll just play it.
Chapter 11. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. By faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts. And by it he, being dead, yet speaketh. By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation he had this testimony, that he pleased God. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promises in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sand which is by the seashore innumerable.
So, I just want to make this little point. There's so much argument in Christianity. Some people want to try and get back under the law. Some people are believing through faith. But faith has been there since the beginning. It's faith that was saving these patriarchs.
Chapter 11.
So God tested Abram and Abraham, God tested Abraham, and Abraham was willing to sacrifice his promised seed, his only begotten son. In the test of Abraham's faith, Abraham responds to Isaac's inquiry, "Where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" And Abraham responds, "God will provide himself a lamb." A quick look into what a burnt offering means. This is the fact book in my Logos Bible software. It returned this answer. A burnt offering involves the complete burning of an animal or other offering on an altar as an act of worship and surrender to God. So Abraham willing to sacrifice his promised son, it was an act of worship, surrender to God. Dictionary of Biblical Themes. Burnt offering, probably the earliest and most basic form of sacrifice, it is seen fundamentally as a gift to God, either in thanksgiving for his goodness or for atonement for sin. So they believe that Abel did a burnt offering, and that's why his offering was accepted from Cain's. Noah, when he got off the ark, he did a burnt offering sacrifice, and this is a gift to God. So as you can see, Abraham's act was complete surrender, worship, and a gift to God. God, who will in the future provide his own lamb, whom we know is Jesus, for an atonement for all sin. This act forms part of our gospel. So John 1:29, the next day, this is John the Baptist, sees Jesus coming unto him and saith, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." In 1 Corinthians 15:3, this is part of the gospel. Corinthians 15:1-4 is the gospel. So this is verse 3 of the gospel. "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit." So let's do a recap on what we've learned so far. God established his covenant through Abraham, and more importantly, with Sarah. Sarah bore the promised seed Isaac. Sarah says in Genesis 21:6, "When all who hears," and this word "hear" means hear intelligently, "will laugh, will rejoice with me." Romans 9:8, "They which are the children of the flesh are not the children of God." This, I believe, would include those physically circumcised. The circumcision of the flesh was a token of the covenant. And those who are physically descended from Abraham. So these are the children of the flesh. The children of God are those who exhibit the virtues of the Father. Genuine descendants are the spiritual progeny. John the Baptist tells us in Luke 3:8, "God is able of those stones, able of these stones to raise up children to Abraham." In Romans 9:6, "Not all Israel are of Israel." Romans 9:7, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. God bless, that is to endure someone with special power, Sarah. So God bless Sarah. We find Sarah and her power hidden in the definition of Israel, which I showed you before in the previous slide. And what I didn't show you, though, was El. It comes from 4:10. It's the everlasting God, almighty God, most high God, is H410, El. Okay, mighty, the almighty. In Galatians 4:28-29, we brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise, born of the Spirit. So Jesus became the burnt offering. He made atonement for our sins. As Abraham proclaimed, God will provide his own lamb. I often think that Abraham was actually prophesying here. This is when he was going to take his son to slay his son for God. So, just the parallels with Isaac and Jesus. I've just put the scriptures side by side. So in Hebrews, it says, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and when he that had received the promises, offered up his only begotten son. So Jesus, in John 3:16, Jesus is teaching Nicodemus, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So we go down to Genesis 22:7-8, the sacrifice of Isaac. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father, and said, my father. And he said, here am I, my son. And he said, behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. And so they went both of them together. So John the Baptist also makes mention of this. The next day John sees Jesus coming unto him and says, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And in Galatians 1:4, our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father. 1 Peter 2:24, Christ is an example of atoned for our sins. Who his own self bare our sins on his body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. 1 John 4:10, knowing God through love, herein is love, not that we loved God, but he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation of our sins. Propitiation means atonement. So Jesus is the lamb that God provides. And Jesus is called the Lamb of God by John the Baptist. He bears our sins on his body on the tree. This is at his crucifixion. So he was the atonement sacrifice. And that's a burnt offering. A burnt offering is to atone for our sins. And Jesus was the high priest. Because only the high priest could do atonement for sins. We're told that Jesus is the high priest in another verse, but I didn't actually cover it in this slide. So you'll have to temporarily trust me on that. Abraham was told to circumcise the flesh of the foreskin as a token of the covenant between God and Abraham. So a token here, it means a signal. Found David Briggs says, a sign, a pledge of the covenant, circumcision, of an Abrahamic covenant. The Halot says, a sign, a distinguishing mark. Bible sense, a signal, any nonverbal action or gesture that encodes a message. So the token cross verse is in Stephen's address, the call of Abraham. Acts 7:1-8 is the call of Abraham. I'll just play that. I couldn't fit it on the slide, so I've just shown you Acts 7:8 here.
Chapter 7. Then said the high priest, are these things so? And he said, Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Charan, and said unto him, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans, and dwelt in Charan. And from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein ye now dwell. And he gave him none inheritance in it, no, not so much as to set his foot on, yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession, and to his seed after him, when as yet he had no child. And God spake on this wise, that his seed should sojourn in a strange land, and that they should bring them into bondage, and entreat them evil 400 years. And the nation to whom they shall be in bondage will I judge, said God. And after that shall they come forth and serve me in this place. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham begat Isaac, and circumcised him the 8th day. And Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat the 12 patriarchs. Chapter 7.
Sorry, next slide. The token of the covenant cross versus Romans 4:11. I might just play it here.
Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How was it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had, yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. And the father of circumcision, to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had, being yet uncircumcised. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised he was able also to perform. And therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. Now, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses, and was raised again for our justification. Cometh this blessedness then...
Next slide. So a new covenant. I'll just play this for you. It's a new covenant foretold by Jeremiah in 31 to 34. So it's just citing the Jeremiah verse in Hebrews.
Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How was it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision?
My apologies. That's the wrong video in there. Okay. Hebrews 8:7-13. A new covenant foretold by Jeremiah 31:31-34. That's where Hebrews is citing it from. For this is the first covenant. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a covenant, a new covenant, with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the day that I took them from the land, took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. And in that he saith, A new covenant he hath made the first old, now that that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Recall the earlier slide when the Jews were disputing with Jesus whose seed they were. This is a continuation of this understanding. A Jew is not circumcised by the flesh, but inwardly of the heart, the spirit who praises God. It's Romans 2:28-29. Caution against hypocrisy. Verse 28. For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, the law, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Circumcision is made with hands. Circumcision not made with hands. That means not man or flesh, but of Christ. Colossians 2:11, rooted in Jesus. Verse 11, in whom ye also are circumcised with a circumcision was made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. So what is the circumcision of Christ exactly? It is the circumcision of the heart in the spirit. This is Deuteronomy 10:16, the essence of the law. Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart, and be no more stiff-necked. Deuteronomy 30:6, the promise of restoration. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed, to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. Jeremiah 32:40, God's assurance of the people's return. And I will make an everlasting covenant with them, that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, that they shall not depart from me. And the cross verse is Ezekiel 11:19. God will restore Israel, and I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you, and I will take the stony heart out of their flesh, and I will give them a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 36:26, the renewal of Israel. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. 2 Corinthians 3:3, this is Christ's epistle. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in the fleshy tables of the heart. 1 Peter 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So not only was Jesus the Lamb of God to atone for our sins, so we can be reconciled to God, but he also came to baptize us with the Holy Spirit fire to fulfill the new covenant. This is the fear that will be put into our hearts. And a lot of people miss this connection. John 3:3-8. And Jesus answered and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it come, and whither it go. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Sorry, I accidentally clicked it. So remember, Isaac was born after the Spirit. Galatians 4:28-29. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, children are the children of the promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the Spirit, even so it is now. So Isaac is born after the Spirit. Matthew 3:11, the preaching of John the Baptist. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that come after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. John 1:6-8, the forerunner of Christ. And there was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. John 1:9-11, the rejection of Christ. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that come into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. John 1:12-13, the acceptance of Christ. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. You've got that power again. This is Sarah's blessing. Even to them that believe on his name, which are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So Jeremiah 32:40 says, I will put my fear into their hearts. This word fear is H3374, and it's feminine of 3373. So this is feminine fear. Just says fear here. Moral reverence. Brown Diver Briggs also mentions it's a noun, feminine. Fear of God, reverence, piety. In the Bible sense, reverence, fear, a feeling of profound respect for someone or something, often a deity conceived of as fear. Like, fear is feminine. And you're probably asking that question. Some verses that hint to this fact, I'm going to give you them here. Just as Eve was a helper, and in that verse there, Eve was a helpmate, it's H5828, it means aid or help. So just as she was a helper for Adam, our Lord is our helper. Hebrews 13:6. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. And it's more evident in this verse here, John 14:26. But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring you to remembrance all things that I said to you. Psalms 48:3, the glory of God in Zion. God is known in her palaces for a refuge. So a lot of people have a problem with the feminine. And that was the reason why I was given my task to find the true divinity of Eve. And I believe it's the Holy Spirit. And these are just some quick verses that I can show you, although it's not part of my study today. But it kind of leads into it, so that's why I'm giving you a couple of verses. Job 28:28, and he said unto man, he said, behold, the fear of the Lord. This is the same fear in Jeremiah. I'll put my fear into their hearts. Behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and depart from evil is understanding. So wisdom is H2451, and it's also a noun, feminine. Okay, so the new covenant, God's going to put his fear into their hearts. And behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. So God's going to put wisdom into their hearts. So if you're not wanting to look at the feminine aspect here, just disregard it. But this fear is wisdom. God's going to put wisdom into their hearts, just like he did with Solomon. Most haven't made the connection because parts of this understanding have been ripped out of our Bible. I'm talking about the Apocrypha, which means hidden. If you recall, God put wisdom in Solomon's heart, and it's a good example of how we can understand how the Holy Spirit works. So in 1 Kings 10:24, and all the earth sought to Solomon to hear his wisdom. That's the same wisdom on the other slide, which God had put in his heart. So this is in the Apocrypha. It's Ecclesiasticus, or it's called Sirach. It's known by two names. The fear of the Lord is true wisdom. And this is the New Revised Standard Version. It gives you the cross-reference here. So verse 14, to fear the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. She is created with the faithful in the womb. She is made among human beings an eternal foundation, and among their descendants will she abide faithfully. So I've taken a Sirach commentary here, and the reason being is because, remember, the baptism is one of water and one with fire. That's probably too far. Yep, so it's your John baptized you with water, but Jesus was coming to baptize you with the Holy Ghost with fire. So that's why I'm showing this commentary here, because this is verse 14, the fear of the Lord. Like the Hebrew word which it renders may mean the best, her fruit is the chief of sweet meats, too, the most important, the chief of all things necessary for life of man are water and fire. I just found that very interesting. That's right there. He made himself man from the beginning. Here it is, the first meaning. Together at the same time, the subject is wisdom. The faithful is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob with the patterns for these in the womb. Okay, so beginning to fear the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and there they've got the chief of all things necessary for the life of man are water and fire. That's baptism, to being born again. And so to being born again, she's created with the faithful in the womb. As you know, like, you know, John the Baptist, he was filled with wisdom from the womb. Just giving you an idea how that works. So God's covenant is to put wisdom in our hearts. And Proverbs 14:33, wisdom rests in the heart of him who has understanding, but what is in the heart of fools is made known. So this is the word heart. It's H 38:20. The heart, also used figuratively, very widely for the feelings, the will, and even the intellect, likewise for the center of anything. This is the Lexham Theological Word Book. It really gives a good explanation. It's heart, mind, self, inner person, refers to the central organ of the body and to the inner person, generally as the seat of emotions, desires, or the will. While the heart can be used literally for the vital organ, the majority of uses of the term in the Bible treat the heart as the seat of the person's emotions, passions, and thoughts. The heart is the central living, thinking, feeling essence of a person. You can see the Holy Spirit resemblance to wisdom is resting, right? Wisdom rests in the heart of him that has understanding. In John 1:33, and I've used the Holman Christian Study Bible, because it actually has the word rest. In the King James, I think it says dwelling or abiding, which is meaning the same thing, but it's just clearer here. It's the testimony of John concerning Christ. I didn't know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water told me, the one you see the Spirit descending and resting on, he's the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. So just as wisdom rests in the heart of him that has understanding, when Jesus was baptized, we see the Holy Spirit descending from heaven and resting on Jesus. That's pretty cool once you can see the connection here. Wisdom and the Holy Spirit, I believe, are one and the same. And that's what I'm trying to slowly bring about this understanding to prove it to you guys. Jesus is a fine example of how the Holy Spirit works in us, though not teaching for this video, but the first time the word grace appears in the New Testament concerns Jesus. So in Luke 2:40, Jesus presented in the temple, and the child grew and waxed strong in the spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. So this is the first time the word grace appears in the New Testament. It just so happened to be in connection with Jesus. This is after he got circumcised. And grace is 5485, it's charis. A graciousness as gratifying of manner or act, abstractly or concretely, literally or figuratively or spiritually, especially the divine influence upon the heart. And it's a reflection in life, including gratitude. So I just want to quickly flick back. God put wisdom in Solomon's heart. And here we have in Proverbs, wisdom rests in the heart of him who has understanding. And then we have a picture of the Holy Spirit descending from heaven and resting on Jesus. It's the divine influence upon the heart. That's what grace is. Being born again is to be born again in the spirit. Titus 3:4-5. Graces of the heirs of grace. But after that, the kindness and love of God, our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. This word renewing is 3:42. It's renovation. Bloomfield Lexicon says, metaph, renovation or reformation in the heart and life by change from a carnal to a Christian life and produced by the renovating influences of the Holy Spirit. So that just kind of confirms, you know, the divine influence on the upon the heart is the Holy Spirit, which is God putting his fear in our hearts. His fear is wisdom. Washing cross verse, that was by the washing of regeneration. Washing cross verse is John 3:3-5. Except a man being born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. I've already spoken on that in another slide, so I've just summarized it here. Titus 3:5, cross verse for renewing, is Psalm 51:10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. That's the Holy Spirit. Cross verse, Ezekiel 11:19. This is part of the new covenant. I've already read it out, but read it out again. And I'll give them one heart, and I'll put a new spirit within you, and I'll take the stony heart out of their flesh, and I'll give them a heart of flesh. So he's going to put the Holy Spirit in us. That's the new covenant. God's assurance of people's return, and I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for the good of them and for their children after them. I'll make an everlasting covenant with them. So we're back to the everlasting covenant that was made with Abraham, that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, and they shall not depart from me. Jeremiah 31:33, a new covenant. But this shall be the covenant that I make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and I will write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And that is the last of my slides. So, yeah, it's important to see, you know, the female characters and what they represent. And in this case, what Sarah represents the other, well, it's not the other part of the covenant, she's a part of the covenant that God made with Abraham. The seed could only come through her, not through his other wives and his other children. And that seed was Isaac. And Isaac, God told Abraham to go and sacrifice his son. And then when he's just about to do it, God stopped him and said, I swear that I'm going to do these things. And God provided his own lamb, which was Jesus. And to be born again, we must believe that Jesus died for our sins, so we could be washed and renewed and be given the Holy Spirit. And that is the new covenant. God is going to put his fear, that's wisdom, in our hearts. And a lot of people don't, they know certain things in Scripture, but they don't actually connect wisdom and the Holy Spirit together. They don't actually connect the gift of the Holy Spirit as God's covenant promise, which we have. Excuse me. Didn't like that I did that. So back when God was giving an everlasting covenant to Abraham, covenant means divine constitution or ordinance with signs or pledges. Pledges is a promise. The promise of the Holy Spirit. It's a contractual arrangement between God and a person or between human beings which require binding action from one or both parties. And in the Greek alignment is dethike, a contract, especially a divisory will. Jesus come and died for our sins. What did I do that for? The New Testament is like the Lord's will and testament. This is how we inherit. Somebody has to die so we can inherit. It's covenant. It's a will. It's like Jesus' will and testament that he died for our sins and we can inherit the Holy Spirit. Because that's literally what's happening. That's God's covenant. I will put my law in their inward parts. I will write it on their hearts. I will put my fear, wisdom, in their hearts. Just like he did with Solomon. So really, the gospel, the Christian gospel is, it stems from this covenant with Abraham. And because Abraham trusted and had faith and believed in God, was willing to sacrifice his only son, his only begotten, to God. And God imputed righteousness to Abraham. And just like it's imputed to us when we believe. It's that same promise is transferred. This is God's promise. I hope you can see that. I hope I've done a good enough job. I know there was a lot of repetitive verses, but I hope you can see the covenant working through the Old and the New Testament and how it applies to us today. This video has gone on for nearly an hour and a half, so I'm going to end it here and pick up on Side of the Earth in a future video. This is Marlena Elizabeth signing out. Bye for now.
Trials look like gifts of grace when I look to Jesus. How my heart